My daughter Maxine recently did her very first swim lessons. And swim lessons with two-year-olds are not really swim lessons. It was mostly just trying to get them into the water. If you don't know, Maxine's actually a fairly daring child. And so the very first day, there were only four kids in the class, but she got in the water immediately while the other three stood on the shore and cried. So the instructor was impressed with her abilities, but she wasn't always, as daring. As we went further along, some of the kids started to, for instance, put their face into the water, which is the next step toward really learning how to swim, is being able to have your face underwater for a moment before you come up to breathe. And she was not ready to do that, even though other kids were. And so she was ahead of them in some places and not where they were at in other places. It takes time to come to the fullness of our faith as well. It's a progression. There was a man that I know who was told at one point that as he was fishing, he was not catching anything and that he should throw his net to the other side. And he had been fishing his entire life. He had made it his business. And this guy who was telling him to throw his net onto the other side, he thought, what does he know about fishing? Why would I follow his advice? But something in his spirit led him to decide to go ahead and do it, and he caught the largest catch of fish he had ever caught before. And you would think that having an experience like that would make you a lifelong believer in the power of God and the power of Jesus. But still, this man developed as a disciple over time. He would go on to make some of the boldest claims of our faith, that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. I mean, of course, for some of us, that's not a particularly bold claim, right? We know that Jesus is the Messiah. But you don't see a lot of people proclaiming it in the public square. It was a moment of powerful witness, and he was a deep disciple in that moment. But he wasn't always there. He went on to fail. He had a moment when he had experienced God in the fullness, even seeing God's greatness exposed, revealed, and he decided in that moment that he wanted to build a place of worship right there and then, and the only problem was that this person that he followed, Jesus, that wasn't what Jesus wanted. He'd been walking with Jesus for quite some time at that point. You'd think he would understand what it was that Jesus wanted, and yet he got it wrong. He should have known that that wasn't the kind of thing that Jesus was interested in. But then he goes on, he has another amazing moment. He sees Jesus walking on the water, and he decides that he's going to join him, and he does it. And then in the very next moment, he starts to sink, showing that, you know, we have a tendency to think that we sort of hit a level as a disciple and maybe we stay there, but he seems to be able to go from one end to the other in just a moment. He had these amazing highs and these amazing lows, and yet he was a disciple, even though he failed at times. In fact, he was one of the greatest disciples of all time. We're going to be talking about this for the next few weeks, about being a disciple of Jesus Christ. I mean, hopefully, we talk about being a disciple of Jesus Christ in one way or another every single week at church, but we're going to be intentionally focusing on it because we want to talk about how it is that we grow as disciples and how we do that here in our church at Goodrich United Methodist Church. And so we're going to be unveiling a new discipleship pathway. This is part of our VCI process. If you haven't heard about VCI in a while, don't be surprised. We had the period of pandemic, and there wasn't a lot we could do other than survive in some senses. And so some things got waylaid a little bit. But if you remember, VCI stands for Vital Church Initiative, and we had a group of people come in and take a look at our church and our culture and give us advice on ways that we could be more alive. And so we're working toward becoming a more vital church. And one of those things is that they said, you need what we call a discipleship pathway. And that may seem like a bunch of jargon to you, and it is. really, what it's all about is being clear with people how we move from one place to another in our faith journey, how it is that we grow as a disciple. A few weeks ago, you saw a video that gave a little tease of what was coming up with the discipleship pathway, two surfer dudes out in the water, you know, with their blonde wigs. And in case you don't know, our discipleship pathway has a beach theme. That's why the surfer dudes in that video, and that's why all of this, and my lifeguard shirt, which I happen to think, lifeguard is a really good word for a pastor, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Only a few people nodded. All right. I'm going to keep the shirt, though. We are going to have some videos to share with you in this process as well to help you become more familiar with our discipleship pathway. And so we have a video to show you right now.
Imagine, if you will, a person so bizarre that they would forgive their enemies, turn their cheek when someone hit them, and pray for people that try to harm them. They do not ask whether they should forgive, but how often they should forgive. And they are willing to give up all that they have to help someone else. You unlock this door with the key of faith. Beyond it, you can go even deeper in your relationship with Jesus Christ. You end up in a place of both salvation and redemption, a place of both faith and works that are both alive. You have entered the discipleship zone. United Methodist Church. Some 177 years ago, a small group of people decided to form a church, a place for making disciples. And they have been doing that work ever since. They have never stopped. But now they have a new discipleship pathway. What you're about to experience is a new focus on making disciples.
Whoa, bro. I always found myself wanting to go deeper as a disciple of Jesus.
It was not the first time that he had felt this way, and it would not be the last. He is a disciple. What is a disciple? We say a disciple is someone who is a joy-filled Christ follower who makes others' lives better and shares their faith journey. If that's too many words for you, then try this. A disciple learns, lives, and shares because they know Jesus. Put another way, we say that they need to enliven, enrich, and engage their faith in Jesus Christ. It's all about going deeper. But you'll know a disciple when you see one, because they will never be far from the water, the depths of Jesus' love.
So, what is a disciple? Well, as we mentioned in the video, it's important to know that it's not a new concept. It's not as if somehow we've never been making disciples before and we've decided, you know, the way to be a vital church is to make disciples. It's about an age-old process of becoming a follower of Jesus Christ. But we want people to know how to grow. It's important. That's the important part, growth. And we, because of this beach imagery, are talking constantly about going deeper. So I'm on the shore. You're all out in the water, you'll see, because you are disciples already. It's always a question of how deep we want to go. I didn't think about flipping pages on a clipboard. We don't ever want anyone to be stuck. That's the most important thing. So it's about growth. And if you've been coming to church for a long time and nothing has changed in your faith life, then I would say you're more a churchgoer than you are a disciple, because disciples change and grow. But I doubt that anyone here would say, well, no, I've been stagnant the entire time I've been coming to church, because the very nature of following Jesus, the very nature of being a disciple, is that we change and grow. But we for sure don't want anyone at Goodrich United Methodist Church to be stuck. And I will say this, the church as a whole hasn't always been very clear on how it is that people should grow as disciples. Churches should be places that make and form and grow disciples. And that means that you should be able to come to a church with no belief in Jesus Christ and find out there how you come to believe in Christ, and then to go deeper in that belief of Jesus and Jesus as the Messiah. But often, churches in the United States especially, but churches too often have become places where people who already believe go. And if you were not a person who believed, you wouldn't go to a church and you wouldn't end up finding faith there because they weren't clear. It's like we expect people to already be at a certain point out in the water before they even arrive in our midst. And that's a problem. It's fine if someone who already does believe in Jesus comes to our church, but our goal should also be to bring people to discipleship and to make disciples. So it's got to be a place where those who already are disciples, you're in the water, can find ways to go deeper. But there are lots of people that are on the shore who look out at the water and they think, that's really kind of attractive. I like the look of it, but I don't know if that's for me or not. I kind of like it, but I'm not sure. And so they're still here on land. And the point is to get everyone into the water. That's the other thing we said in the video. You'll know a disciple because they're in the water. I know that Goodrich United Methodist Church has made disciples, and so I want to be clear again that this is not about saying that we haven't, but it's a time for us to be more intentional about making disciples. The reality is that faith in the United States has changed. What you tend to hear on the news is that we are declining just across the board. There are even churches that, if you actually look into the statistics, they will tell you they're growing and they may not be. Not individual churches. There are individual churches that are growing, but most churches are seeing decline, and I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that we're not clear about how it is that you become a disciple. So this is all about becoming clearer. And so we have this new pathway. You're going to see it up on the screen here in a moment, so that you can look at it for the first time. And if you're here with us in person, there will be copies available for you after worship that you can take home. They're printed on good hard cardstock, and I would encourage you to stick it up on your fridge and have this in front of you all the time. And if you're worshiping with us online today, you can head over to goodrichumc.org/discipleship, and you'll find the discipleship pathway there. You can print off a copy for yourself. If you want it printed on really nice paper, go ahead and contact the church office. We would love to mail you one printed on nice paper that you can put up on your fridge as well. But you can also print it off yourself and put it up there. You'll see these different designations that talk about where people are in their faith. Beachcombers, toe dippers, wave riders, deep divers. We're going to be talking more about those things next week. This week, we're really talking about what it is to be a disciple. And what I said before is that we are using this word deeper, and I think it's a really good word to talk about always how we're going deeper in our faith. C.S. Lewis had a phrase in one of his books from the Chronicles of Narnia, the final book, The Last Battle is what that book is called. And in that, he says that we come further up and further in. So it's got that same sort of messaging that we're always seeking to go deeper. And so we're inviting people to go deeper. And so we have this whole water theme. And you even hear water, hopefully. It's very faint. But if you pay attention, you'll hear some lapping waves. We're trying to get you in the beach mood, if you aren't already. And the whole point is that we wanted to use the ocean because, as you know, the ocean is very deep. In fact, there are depths of the ocean that we have a hard time even exploring because we send equipment down there, and the deeper you go, it destroys that equipment with its pressure. We think it's a great metaphor for faith, because the reality is no matter how deep of a disciple you are, there may be depths of faith that we have not explored. Well, not maybe, there are. You know, when we come to the end of this life, we know certain things as people of faith about what happens, but there's a whole lot unknown, and we most often talk about God as a mystery, because God is so much more than our minds can understand in many ways. So I think this is really great. The reality is that as you go deeper, you become a stranger creature. That's why we used the Twilight Zone theme for the video this week, because the discipleship zone ends up making strange people who do things that the world would not understand, like forgiving people who don't seem like they are forgivable. And it's a good metaphor to go with the water again, because you know also that if you go deep in the ocean, you end up finding very strange creatures down there as well. The deeper we go, the weirder they are, and the weirder they look, and they function in ways that we don't expect. It's amazing. So I think it's a great metaphor. No matter what, we are meant to grow. And that growth looks strange as well at times. It may look like failure or loss. And so if you remember the person I was talking about at the beginning, I'm sure that you knew after a while who I was talking about. At first, you all thought I was just telling a story, right? But I was talking about a very specific disciple. Sometimes he was at the best of his faith, and other times he wasn't. But all along the way, he was growing as a disciple of Christ. And he would go on to be one of the most important and influential Christians of all time. And you know him as the Rock. No, not Dwayne Johnson. Peter, which means rock. And it was a nickname that Jesus gave him. His name was Simon, and Jesus said, well, I'm going to call you Peter because you're going to be the rock that I build my church on. Jesus gave him that name long before many of these failures ever happened. Jesus saw the kind of disciple he was going to become, and Jesus invested in his growth, and Peter continued to grow as a disciple. He was on a pathway as well. It may not have been our pathway exactly, but he was all about going deeper. And the reality is that sometimes going deeper means falling back, or seeming to fall back, sorry. So our discipleship pathway is meant to help you figure out where you're at, and as I said, we'll talk more about that next week. But we're going to always want to be growing deeper and going further in our relationship with Jesus. But sometimes that will look like falling back. And so there will be times when we'll feel like, oh, I failed. But look to Scripture. You'll see people who appear to fail as well, and yet God helps them to grow into even deeper disciples through that process. Amen. So, what is a disciple? Well, I'm going to have you, Elizabeth doesn't know this, I forgot to mention to you, but there's a little slideshow. I want you to move there. It's going to show the discipleship pathway first. And you'll notice that there are three words on here. She's going to click to the next slide. The first word is enliven. So you heard us mention these in the video as well. What we said about a disciple is this long phrase. It's a joy-filled Christ follower who makes others' lives better and shares their faith journey, which is a mouthful, right? And I've already made you memorize our vision statement, and so I thought, there's no way I make you memorize all of that. So we have these three words that we've encapsulated it with. Enliven, and then the next one, we're going to zoom back out. Enrich, and the next one, we're going to zoom back out. Engage. These three words, enliven, enrich, and engage. You enliven is a word meant, and I used three other words in the video as well, to talk about how we learn and grow in our own faith through learning. Enriching is about enriching others' lives. That's how we live out our faith. And then engaging in sharing Christ. So we share Christ. So those are those three elements you hear in a joy-filled Christ follower who makes others' lives better and... Oh, good, yeah. She's following right along with me now. If you hit that next slide, please. It's going to make it so they can actually read it, because I realized how small that was. Those three words encapsulate this. Makes others' lives better and shares their faith journey. These are these three things. How are you a Christ follower? Well, that's all about learning and continuing to go deeper in that way. How do you live your faith out? You enrich others' lives. And how is it that you engage in sharing Christ? You share your faith journey. That's about sharing. So we learn, live, and share, or we say enliven, enrich, and engage. So those are things to focus on. And they're simple, broad categories. It's not meant to point to the totality of discipleship necessarily, but we do think it's more helpful than the wordy definition. And it does give us a general sense of what a disciple is. These three main areas, really, if you were living into those three, you really are a disciple. And you might say, well, isn't sharing your faith part of living out your faith? Yes, but we think it's so important that we wanted to mention it as a third part. It is vitally important, especially as we talk about being disciples and making disciples. One of the ways that we do that is to share our faith with others. That's how others come to become disciples as well. And so in each of these areas, you may be in different places. And we'll be, again, talking about that more next week. but you are meant to be growing in each of them and changing in each of them. It's about not being static. You may think that you're further behind in one area than you once were, that you may have slid back, and as I mentioned before, sometimes it can appear that we slid back. There are times when that's actually true. We are a people that believe that we can fall into sin and slide back out of a true form of discipleship. But I want to encourage you to realize that more often than not, those places where we perceive it as a failure are more likely a place where God is trying to work in us to help us grow deeper in our faith. Just like Peter, who appeared to fail miserably many a time, and yet was the rock that Christ built the church on. So we want all of us to grow. We want not to just stay in the same place. We want to be a church full of people who are on the path to being deeper disciples, strange creatures of the deep of faith, right? Who people would look at us and think, "Ooh, they look a little strange. This is like being in the Twilight Zone." And we want to be a place as well where those that are still on the beach, who are just looking at the water and thinking, "I mean, that seems interesting, but I don't know if it's for me," that they can find a way to begin to get their feet in the water and then the whole way in. That was really the process for these little kids in their beginning swim lessons. It was all about, you know, can you just come a little bit deeper and go a little further into the water? Can you sit down in the water now? Can you flop over in the water? Can you put your head under the water for a moment? This is the nature of making disciples as well. We don't take people and chuck them out into the water and say, "Hope you can swim," right? That's not what it's about. We bring them along slowly through the process of discipleship. Disciples grow, change, and go deep as they learn, live, and share, or as they enliven, enrich, and engage. And so this whole next few weeks is going to be about going deeper as disciples. And I invite you to come and get in the water and go deeper. Amen.